I've been attending this program and I've been listening to such fascinating presentation that I'm a little nervous now. And I must tell this disclaimer before I start my presentation that I had a weak economic gene, and that's why I took up medicine. My biology gene was stronger. That's why my parents' vision was that I should be apt for medicine and not for any other subject. So here I am. I'm going to talk a little on bringing clinical practice into patient-centric innovation. So the first thing that I just spoke about this recently in a TED talk that I gave last month, that science would be incomplete if it only remains a hope for the future without serving the present, without serving the needy, and without making it accessible. Now, that is where intentions in innovations are the key driving force for any breakthrough in science. Unless I make science accessible, there is no point in me making innovations for the society. I often look at this and I say that when Newton saw the apple, he saw a formula. When Steve Jobs saw the apple, he saw a computer. The point is about asking the right question in innovations. And a lot of the time, it is that driving question that actually changes everything. I have several of my researcher friends who spend years together searching a question and yet don't find a decent question, and then spend the rest of the years finding an answer to that question. So finding a question is not easy. I mean, you Google it, you'll understand that every single question, majority in this world has been answered. So finding the right question is actually one of the core driving principles of innovation. Often people come and ask me, especially younger colleagues, junior students, they ask me, sir, where is the scope of work? Where can I be successful? Which branch should I take up? I'm already completed my MBBS. I heard that radiology has very good scope. I always tell them, don't get driven by markets. They mislead you. My point was that whenever you read a book, a chapter, a particular topic, you sometimes connect with one of these subjects in your course. Pursue them, because those are the areas. You know, whenever you read such kind of chapters, you feel like you're meeting an old friend, you're having a conversation with that particular chapter. You connect so much with it that you feel that this may be actually a part of my life. Now, those are the topics you should pursue. Rather than ask me the question, where is the scope for medicine? I don't know. When I took up oncology, everybody told me it doesn't make sense. No gratification, not much money, patient satisfaction, not very high. You may remove a throat, tongue, they're not going to come and thank you for it. There were cosmetology, there was radiology, more scope for it. But there was something from my first year of medicine that connected me with my subject. I still remember my first year professor, when we used to sit in the dissection lab for hours together dissecting the voice nerve. He would tell me, you know, this is a very fascinating voice box. It is something very mysterious about the way it functions and very unique about it. And from that day onwards, I've been dissecting the voice boxes, I've been dissecting the larynxes, and it's been 18 years. And I still continue to do these. But what connected me with that subject, I still don't know. But I know it connected me with that subject. Another thing that I often say is ambition to purpose. For every single thing that you want to do, if there is no purpose, it will be without the soul. And this is what I have always experienced, that it is ambition to purpose that will actually reveal the path to fail successfully. I have often found it, whether it's Mahatma Gandhi or whether it is Mother Teresa, they've all lived their lives through an example of combining these two. And whenever you come into a combination of these, I think that's a fission reaction. That's explosive. You realize that something new comes out of it. And that's the driving force. So if innovations is ambition, then purpose is intentions. They two come together, it changes the world. And that's what we need. Now today, we've become experts in innovating illnesses. We've actually become innovating experts in illnesses. We've innovated so many illnesses that I think now we are working to innovate things to innovate these particular problems. So we are a unique lot in the 21st century. We call this the paradox of the 21st century, that you first innovate illnesses, then you innovate to solve these innovations. So here we are, a whole bunch of problems innovated by us, and you see world over, the problem today has been NCDs with the part of communicable diseases, but all are creation. I often look at it as a head and neck surgeon. 95% of my cancers are related to tobacco. And yet, we are spending millions of dollars to innovate a new drug that is going to extend the life by 3 months and at a cost of 5 lakhs. Why not doing tobacco control? I know I'm standing at the wrong platform today talking about this, but yet feel, I think I should complete this particular dialogue to tell this, that I feel that we are all innovated illnesses. I often feel we are the oral cancer hub of the world. And here we surgeons feel proud that we are able to remove a jaw and put in a new jaw, when actually you can prevent this problem. I often see those 20-year-old removing a tongue, a jaw. I feel miserable. I feel we could have prevented this. Chewing tobacco ban could have been the solution for actual oral cancers in India, rather than feeling proud in an international forum and saying that we remove 1,000 jaws in a day. I think that doesn't make sense. So, I think the core of innovation, today we are talking about clinical practice and we are talking about innovation. So I connected a lot with this particular slide, and I don't know if somebody knows about this, and I pardon for this repetition. This was a particular task given to a cola marketing guy in the Middle East, and he was asked to come up with a unique formula of marketing. So when his friends asked, he said, I've come up with a very interesting marketing style which is going to be pictorial and hence will convey the message more robust. And you know, couple of months later, his friend met him and he said, I was thrown out of the job. He said, what happened? He said, my conceptual model was wonderful. You know, man lying in the desert, drinks coke, runs. Wonderful. But what happened? He said, I missed one point. He said, they read from right to left. I missed the point. Now, I think a lot of such things are happening in medicine. And I must tell you all this because sitting in the core of it, I witnessed this very commonly. I come across at least one or two people in a week who come and tell me, sir, I've come up with a new solution. And I said, yes. And they come up with a plan and they say, this is what you should be using. Now, I think we have a mixture of tech and tech experts and doctors here. You must admit that the behavioral change to be brought out in a doctor is the worst. It's so difficult to bring out a behavioral change in a doctor to change his practice. It's not easy. So, naturally, when you come up with a solution which you have come up with but is not relevant for him, he's not going to change. Now, a lot of the things, today I was, just last week I was given a proposal by a very reputed organization to tell that come up with a solution and we'll help you. So it was this engineering college that was actually giving us some fund for creating some innovative solution. The problem should come from the medical world and the innovation come from the other side. It's going totally reverse. And that's where every single roadblock is happening, I feel. That you're going in the reverse way and that's how you're not able to innovate in relevant stuff. So I'll just speak a couple of slides on what we did. So the Aum Voice Prosthesis is a recent voice prosthesis that we have developed. And just the important aspect of this particular problem was why we did this. So we created a $1 speaking device for throat cancer patients because they can't speak. If you see this gentleman here, he can't speak because his voice box has been removed. He was a watchman. He smoked for about 20, 30 years BDs. Eventually got cancers. And you know what happens to a laryngectomy? You can't speak. You can't smell through your nose because you breathe through a hole in the throat. You can't eat your foods normally. So life is just not the same again. So in this kind of a scenario, when they live like this, now what happens is there are ways to make them speak. So the conventional devices that are available today in the market are costing somewhere between 20,000 to 45,000 rupees, which make them speak again. Now, this particular problem came across to me when I saw a gentleman from a particular village near Bangalore called Chikballapur. This gentleman came up to me with the health officer and asked me, can you help us make this patient speak? So typically I would request donations and I would actually get these patients to speak again. They told me that this gentleman was the lifeline of his village. He was the lifeline of his Gram Panchayat. He was a very active, avid speaker. He would entertain everybody, very knowledgeable gentleman, and suddenly one day because of BD smoking lost his voice box. They said, sir, he's a villager and what do we do with it? So that's when I actually thought up and I said that I really know I should try something. And that day was serendipity because that day I came across my friend after this patient went out, who came and told me that he's an industrialist, so he came and told me that he was looking at some particular problem, and when we were chatting, I asked him, can you help me with this donation for this particular patient? And he said, surely I'll do it for you, but he said, how long are you going to go on doing this? And for how many people? So he said, why don't you come up with something that you feel could be actually possible? And that's when me and him got together and created a device which we felt could be actually useful for our cancer patients. The turning point in my life was, I met a patient who had not spoken for 16 years. Sir, please try not speaking for a minute. I know I'm forced for the next 25 minutes not to allow you all to speak, but try speaking, try keeping quiet for a minute, and you'll see how difficult it is. Imagine this man kept quiet for 16 years. 16 years, and I asked him why. He said, I couldn't afford it. So I felt that speech is a right. It is not a privilege. Speech is beyond sustaining your life force. It is a right to freedom, justice, dignity, and peace. How could we say to somebody, when nature created us, it gave us a voice box for free, nobody charged us for it. How can we say, only if you pay this much will you be speaking, if you pay this much you won't speak? I think that was something that was going wrong, so we did something that we created this voice device. And I again reiterate that it was not for religious purposes, but it was just because Aum denotes the sound. And that's why we came out with this particular voice processes that could help these patients. So Ramakrishna was a watchman. I remember 3 years back I operated on him, removed his voice box. He was a watchman, lost his job because he said, I can't raise an alarm now. He came to me and said, sir, do something. We raised some donation, fitted him a voice box. 3 years later, he comes back to me. So he got his job back. And 3 years later, he comes back to me saying, sir, voice box is spoiled. Ideally, the life of the voice box was 6 months, but he dragged on with that for 3 years. And eventually, he said, the voice box is now not functioning. So he said, can you help me again? And that's when I fitted him with the new voice machine and told him that that he could speak again. And that's how he did. I'm just playing this little video that we created at HCG for the device. Can you have the voice? Can you raise the volume?
This is the voice of India.
Sisters and brothers of America.
I regard myself as a soldier, though a soldier of peace.
My countrymen in East Asia, while I am in Tokyo, I desire to address a few words to you, and I have no doubt that you will give them due consideration.
Unfortunately, thousands of these strong voices are silenced every day by throat cancer. Not many can afford the treatment they need to get their voice back, and they suffer in silence. It's time we changed that. For the first time in India, there is a voice prosthesis device for the world. Aum is a next-generation voice prosthesis device that offers a new lease of life to those who have lost their voice from throat cancer. Because the freedom of speech is every Indian's right.
My voice is my birthright.
My voice is my birthright.
So, it was as simple as that, make them speak with $1. And what we did, we had a philosophy in what we did. So now you may understand, how does one speak if he has lost his voice box? Isn't that strange that you've lost your voice box and then a person speaks again? So this is what I want to connect with you about my years of work. You know, one thing that I came to know through my years of work was we don't speak through our throat. Isn't that strange? We all thought we speak through our throats. We speak through our brain. We all speak through our brain. We do not speak through our throat. Now, how did the science of this particular speech evolve? In the early 30s, there was a gentleman who, after losing his voice box, got frustrated, took a heated ice pick, stabbed himself in the throat. The result, he did not die, he started to speak. So, the science of speech was taught to the doctor by a patient. And this is where, again, patient-centric innovations is key, because it is always these patients who teach us innovations. It's not the doctor who come out with innovative solutions. This patient has never got a mention in history. So I want to place it on record and admit that there was nothing innovative about what we did. It was what that man taught us, that is what we learned. That he said that I had made an experiment on myself and I began to speak. So what we got to know was, and this is known from the 1863 onwards when Boccas actually gave this concept and said that the brain speaks. So whenever I ask, if I ask you a question, what is your name? It goes, what is your name? To the ear, from there to the auditory cortex, to the Boccas areas, Wernicke's areas, auditory cortex, and then the auditory cortex and the motor cortex will instruct your throat to tell vibrate in this way to create these particular vowels in these sound. Strange, and that's how the brain speaks. So if the throat is not there and if you put something else and supply air, the brain will tell it to do the same thing. We've got a patient who doesn't even have a food pipe but a stomach here and he still speaks. The brain tells him what to do and he's able to speak. It's a simple thing, it's not complex at all. So just to give you another example on and confirm this, after I did this device, several people came to meet me. Among them was one very interesting patient. He came to me, sat in front of me and said, "Doctor, I think," he said he's come from Vishakhapatnam. He said, "I think I have throat cancer for the last 1 year. My voice has deteriorated. I've not been able to speak correctly. There's been a problem." And then I asked him, I said, "Where do you come from and what's your name?" And he said, "You're talking very irrelevant." And I said, "No, I said, I'm asking you what's your name." He again said, "You're talking very irrelevant. I always thought my wife only thinks that I talk irrelevant. Rest of them at least think I am talking irrelevant." So this man insistently said, "No, you're talking irrelevant." And then I asked him, "Can you write down and tell me what's your name?" So he wrote down correctly, my name is so and so and I come from Vishakhapatnam. Now, I just told my junior colleague sitting there that this man has had a stroke of the brain. I said, "There's nothing to do with cancer." I said, "Get an MRI done for him, just get the stroke detected and send it to a neurologist." Now that was strange. They said, "How did you pick it up?" I said, "See, long back when I did my posting in NIMHANS, I was sitting one day spending some time in the library because I had actually missed one class. And I was just sitting on that table and I flipped through two pages that I read of a very famous neurologist by name Gleick. And out of interest in those two pages, I read that the brain speaks and it is not the throat. And he wrote some few principles. Those two pages were the ones which I remembered only. And I said that this man's got a stroke because the dictionary center of the brain, from where you bring out the words, is jumbled up. So it can't put it in order and come out with a reply. And that's what he is. He rightfully had that. So I told him, I sent it to my speech therapist and said, "See, his left brain has got a stroke. His right brain is intact. Make him sing his name. Because singing artistry is controlled by the right brain, he can still use it, so he can sing his name." That's speech, that's simple. And I say, I'm not a neurologist, I have no clue. And I told my nursing staff also, don't send me neurology patients henceforth, because I'm gonna get muddled up into my own work and get further confused. But the point was, I think it's simple. It's clinical solutions sometimes are very, very simple. So we priced it at 50 rupees, there were a couple of reasons. One thing was, we actually wanted to make a point, because today the medical world has become a questionable entity. There is a lot of questions raised because of lack of communication, lack of concern, commercialization. We doctors are questioned time and again. And somewhere I know that my teachers, my colleagues, we go back late, we spend extra hours, we compromise family life, yet when I see the headline news or when I see TV9 showing some very interesting clippings, I feel bad. I feel bad that there are so many of us working hard here, and why is this particular field being portrayed in such a poor light? I mean, there is an economic angle to everything, but I think things have not gone so bad that this has to be happening, and that's where we wanted to send out a stronger message. Second is, we wanted to make every throat cancer patient speak because we felt it was a right. And the third thing was, I think, accessibility to science. We wanted every single person who needed this to make it accessible so that they speak again. And someone asked me this, saying it's not viable, and I said, "I don't know, it doesn't make sense to me, but I just want that fellow to speak." And just an example for that was a man who traveled from Durgapur, who came and told us that, "Sir," he came from Durgapur hearing about this. He said that, "Sir, I had heard about this and I wanted this particular." He had a throat cancer, he came with three plasters on his face, leaking throat, and somebody had told him that 50 rupees something he can get over here, and we are running the clinical study here. So he came down here, and he didn't even have money to pay the registration fee, and Dr. Basaraj will forgive me for this, I didn't charge him registration. So he told us that, you know, "I don't even have registration money, and how could you?" So we asked him to come on to the study, and we told him we'll fit in this process. This gentleman, it's a 10-minute procedure in the OP to fit this machine. And at the end of 10 minutes, I told my colleague, she knew Bengali, so I told her, "Just teach this patient, send him home." At 8:30, when my OPD was over and I was coming out, this man was still sitting. And I wondered, why is he still sitting? So he came close, he came running and gave me a tight hug. I thought it was an attack. I wanted to call sir for emergency rescues. But you know, this man actually wanted to give his gratitude and say thank you. He said, sir, abhi to humne socha ke parchi niklega, phir admission hoga, phir uske baad procedure karega, phir do din ke baad discharge hoga. Abhi to hum baat kar rahe hai, sir. And I said, bhai, bahut simple hai, isiliye. But that satisfaction only I saw. I don't know how many saw it there, but I saw it and I felt I've done my work. And I'm coming to my last slide, pardon me. Okay. So she told me she's going to do this. I was waiting for that. Sorry, I didn't see that. I had a larger message to give for this prosthesis, that every patient who takes this prosthesis, I said my goal was not to sell more prosthesis. And I'm least interested in that. I don't have an economic sense anyways. My point was, I think it should go out as a message to every smoker to say, quit smoking. You know, I don't want to sell these prosthesis more and more. For whoever is there, I'll help them. And that's why our first goal at HCG was to reach out to all the regional cancer centers. And my chairman and my entire team at HCG has to be thanked for, because my chairman believed in freedom of speech. And he pushed me and said, go out and do this. And here we are. After that, we've come up with something else. Again, I'm just giving this example. I've come up with this tracheostomy tube because my OT ward boy, and sir will know, Praveen's uncle came up with breathlessness. We had to do an emergency tracheostomy, he didn't have money. We went ahead and did that emergency tracheostomy and we put in a tracheostomy tube. And after that we discharged him. We taught him suctioning and discharged him. He went back home and died in Chikmagalur in a village because there was no suctioning correctly done. I felt pathetic. I felt we've lost our life without suction. That's the worst we could have had. And you know, I just casually following it up. Death in India is so cheap that it doesn't matter for us. So that man, OT boy, told me, he said, illa sir, Rao, sapodri, yen maadu. But I felt very bad and we came up with a device that does not need suctioning. So this device does not need suctioning. You can use it in a village. And it comes at, I don't know the cost yet, but I think we've designed it. We filed our patents for it. And hopefully in the next coming days, we'll come out with this and try to reach out to more people across India who are going to go to villages and not die because of no suction. So that's something simple. The last part of it is, I've come up with, we actually presented this data recently, we filed our patents for it. We were working with a quantum physicist and a chemist. I'm a surgeon, I know it's a weird combination, but we've been looking at certain problems in oncology on trying to explain the actual theory. Like for example, I'll just give you all a very strange example. Imagine you hold a live wire today, what would happen to you? You'll get a shock. Okay, I'll give you scenario number two. You hold a live wire, you have lunch, you go back to your office, work, go back to sleep, 20 years later you get a shock. Now someone shifts you to the hospital and a doctor like me comes there, examines you and says, have you ever held a live wire before? And you say, yeah, 20 years back. And I say, oh, that's the reason for your shock. How do you explain this? So my theory explains something on that. Basically it tells a smoker who starts at 15, smokes until 25, gets cancer at 55, how on earth do you explain it? How on earth do you explain carcinogenesis like this? I did that 15, 20 years back, I am now a reformed man, why me? A lot of people are asking this question today. So this particular theory goes on to explain why this particular problem happens, at which level it happens and how does it happen. So we filed our patents for it, we got through with that. The paper is under review. I'm sure we are working on drug discoveries to look at what pathways we could explore. We are also working to see if we can pick up cancer at the electron level. Forget about at the cellular level. And I must tell you all one thing, that genetics is not working. And I know I'm making a strong statement. I made it at Indian Institute of Science also. I said, tell me one gene that has changed the game of cancer, zero. There is only, even in identical twins with the same genome, one has cancer, one does not have, you can't say which gene. Because the universe of genes functions in a very strange way. So there is now something called epigenetics that people are trying to understand. See, when does one gene switch on and one switch off? Tell me one cancer gene that has changed the game, you can't answer this question. So genes don't have a value, it's something else that's going on. It's a long theory, but I just wanted to tell you that from clinical points, we come back to this. My last slide, Justice M.N. Venkatachalaya has been my mentor, guide. He inspired me into several things, and this is something beautifully told me. He said, India's concept of development should be looked beyond the limited concept of GDP, which even could be achieved through smugglers and pirates running this country. we should envision an India that is actually standing tall to inspire the world and looking at development as an expansion of freedom. And for me, it was freedom of speech that I worked on. So that was something wonderful, because if I walk from my house to the hospital, my GDP is low. If I go in a car, the GDP is better. If I die in an accident, the GDP is highest. I don't think it makes sense. So thank you very much. The last point I wanted to say was, I think something beautiful happened. You know, when Jamshedji Tata and Swami Vivekananda were traveling together from Japan to Chicago, they discussed on the idea of science, and what came out was Indian Institute of Science. So that's when ambition and purpose, intention and innovations come together, you see transformations happen. Thank you very much.
Hello, Dr. Rao. I'm Pankam from Berkeley Health EDU. No question. Just to say that to hear a doctor talk like you, fantastic. Thank you so much. Anyone else from the audience?
Somebody asked
Doctor,
me.
Doctor, I know I'm going to be, you know, maybe not liked by many when I ask you this. Why did you put it at $1 only? You could have made some revenue out of it, used it for some other purpose.
So several people asked
cheap,
me this.
Very cheap.
No, I know several people asked me this, and I said, I want to show a science of speech in this. There was nothing else. And then they asked me, I said, like somebody came and met me and said, at least 1,000 rupees to rakhna chahiye. I said, 1,000. I said, oh, 950 rupees mein main kya karunga? So he said, वो तुम बिल्डिंग बना सकता है, इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इनोवेशन बना सकता है, तुम उसको सेल सस्टेन करो, वो ऐसे वो तो सब मैं करूंगा ये पढ़ ले. I said, you forget about all that. That I'll anyway do. Do I have to do 950 rupees for that? The point was, majority of the patients that I deal with are patients who are labor class, whose monthly earning is about 5,000 rupees. Monthly. Now, I'm see, like one of my rich patients came and told me, sir, मेरे को 50 रुपए का आपका मशीन नहीं चाहिए. I said that when a Mercedes exists, a Tata Nano can exist, or a cycle can exist. You know, if metformin will be available at 500 rupees so that only a rich elite class can become a diabetic and not a poor man, I don't think it makes sense. So the point was making it accessible. I am not against any company, nor am I competing with anybody. I am just saying, let my poor patient speak. Why are you going to say, you know, I got tired and frustrated pleading for donations or asking somebody to say that that company fellow to reduce that amount. I felt make it simpler, and I think thanks to all of them that this happened. Yeah, as of now it is on clinical study, but I must tell you all, we've used the world's best material, that is platinum cured silicone, without compromise. We've just used science in its simple, accessible way to create something which is of good quality. Not that I want to give a donation of old tone clothes to my poor patients. I wanted to get the world's best quality, which is sustainable, which is strong, which is durable. And that's how we got this. So we assume that it is at least going to be 6 months, without a doubt. Indian studies show that it can come up to 2 years, but I'm not bothered because I've kept it so low that I can change it every month. So it's quite simple. Still cheap. I'm trying to compete with Bisleri. I don't think I'll be able to.
Dr. Vishal, I totally believe in destiny, because he kind of had a muddled up morning. He double booked for two speaking slots and kept confirming those people, oh, I've sent the presentation to Vishal, I've sent it. And then he strolled into ITC, which I'm very happy about, because their loss is our gain. I request Mr. Mohit Malhotra to please give Dr. Rao a memento.
Mercedes to bicycle.